Jay Vangorden here with FCP Euro, working on this 2013 Volvo XC60. We're going to be replacing the rear pads and rear rotors. We're going to be installing Zimmerman Z-coated rear rotors along with the Ate OEM pads. The pads come with shims and also new caliper bolts. Typically, you'll see these fail anywhere from 50 to 75,000 miles. What you want to look out for is the condition of the pad. Now, you could typically get a sense for the wear on these pads by looking through the wheel. Rear pads, you want to replace at about 4 millimeters of thickness. As you can see, this one is well beyond that and probably a millimeter or less compared to full thickness here. Just keep in mind, when you're looking at the outboard pad and you're gauging when to replace your brake pads based off of that, always remember that the inboard pad is always going to be wearing a lot more than the outboard pad. And the reason for that is that's because the piston is constantly pushing more pressure on the inboard pad as opposed to the outer. When it comes to the rotors, what you want to look out for is any type of rust, any blue spot, any heat spots, or any type of grooving on the outside. Me personally, since you're replacing these at such higher mileage on these cars, I'm going to recommend to replace the rotors anyhow whenever you're replacing the brake pads. This is just for a peace of mind, knowing that you have fresh new rotors paired with your fresh new pads. And again, this job will apply to all the P3 chassis vehicles. The rotors may look a little different from vehicle to vehicle, but the general steps are going to be the same across all different models. One other thing is when you're working on these cars, this is for the P3 family of the Volvo. Anything that comes with a electronic rear parking brake, you're going to need a tool to release the actuator motor. And that's going to allow you to service the rear brakes as well. Let's take a look at the tools we're going to need for this job. Some of the tools you'll need for this job are a half inch breaker bar, a half inch torque wrench that's capable of torquing 110 newton meters, a 3/8 torque wrench capable of torquing 35 newton meters, a 3/8 ratchet, multiple extensions like a 3-inch and a 6-inch, a universal, a 13 millimeter wrench, a 15 millimeter wrench, a 16 millimeter wrench, a T50 Torx, a hammer, screwdriver, wire brush, some silicone grease for the pads, some brake clean to clean off all the debris, and some channel lock pliers to compress the caliper piston. Don't forget, one last thing very important on this particular model is the scan tool, and that's to activate service mode on your electronic parking brake. All right, first and foremost, you want to lift and support the vehicle. We're using a lift today for demonstration purposes. If you're at home, you may be using a jack and some jack stands. If that's the case, I suggest that you take a breaker bar and crack the lugs loose first before jacking. But since I'm on the lift and I have an impact, I'm gonna take the wheel off now. All right, now with the wheels off, the next step that you're gonna want to do is go in the car, turn the ignition on, plug in your scan tool, and retract the electronic parking brake. Let's go do that now. All right, so now we're in the car. We have our scanner. This is the Autel MX808. You can use this scanner that we have on our website. We'll add a link above, just in case you needed one. You're gonna use this and plug it in down here on the left-hand side. That's where the DLC connector is. Plug that in, turn the key to position 2. You do that by holding it down for 3 seconds. All the lights on the dashboard will come on. That'll indicate key position 2, not 1. Turn on the scanner. We're going to select Volvo. Automatic select. Hit read to read the VIN. VIN is correct, so hit OK. Yes, confirm. Go to hot function. And it's going to say replace brake pads. Click on that. And please release the parking brake. Hit start. And you'll actually hear the motor in the back retracting. Now the scanner is going to say that's in service mode. You could turn the key off, go replace your pads, rotors, and then come back on and release again. Turn the ignition switch off, replace the brake pad and finish installation. Turn the ignition switch on. Please click OK to proceed. So at this time, put the scanner on the side. Turn key off, and let's go move on with our installation. All right, so at this point in the procedure, you may be wondering, how do I know if I have electronic parking brake? Well, Most of the P3 chassis Volvo family does come with electronic parking brake. Some of the earlier V70s did not. Same thing with the S80s, they had a foot brake. The older models, you know, beforehand, even the P1s and the P2s, they all came with a traditional cable style. It wasn't until the P3 that they started incorporating the electronic parking brake. This is the easiest way to tell. If you're looking at the wheel anyhow, is you're gonna see this big black motor sitting on the back. And basically it's, you know, it's parking brake by wire. So there's a switch inside the car. When you want to engage your parking brake, you just flick the switch and there's an electronic screw in here. It screws into the pad and applies pressure to the pad and the rotor. So on the opposite end of that, if you do not have EPB or electronic parking brake, you're going to have the conventional a cable or a foot pedal inside the car. That's going to engage your parking brake and you will not have this big black motor on the caliper. Lastly, if you do not have a scan tool, there are some unauthorized methods of retracting this brake. You can actually, there's some bolts on the back here and you can take the motor apart and this way remove it from the caliper assembly, do your brake work, reassemble it and put it back on. However, it is a little bit risky. It runs a risk of breaking some of the components, even the motor, which is pretty expensive. All right, next I'm gonna take a trash can and just place it underneath the rotor. And the reason for that is just keep the floor clean. As you're working on your brake components, all types of debris and rust is going to fall down. So if you're working on your garage floor or driveway, I suggest putting down a towel or something just to, you know, protect the floor area. Next, there's going to be two 13 millimeter bolts that hold the caliper to the caliper bracket. Let's remove those. There's going to be a counter hold. You can use a 16 millimeter wrench. If you have a thinner wrench, the head of this is a little thick, so it's a little tough to get in there initially. So if you have vice grips or a thinner wrench to get in there, that's gonna help. But I'm gonna use a hammer just to tap it in, just the counter hold while I break these loose and remove them. Now we're going to remove the caliper and just set it off to the side. If you have a bungee cord or a wire tie, you can secure it to something up here. On this particular model, it sits pretty nice up on top of the rotor. It doesn't really go anywhere, so I'm comfortable with that. Next, we're going to want to remove the two 15 millimeter bolts that hold down the caliper carrier. All right, next to remove the rotor, there's a T50 Torx. Now these can be stubborn at times, so you could go about it a few different ways. What I typically do first is just put the T50 inside the screw, take a hammer and just shock it. Then I'll try to use an impact and see if it comes out that way. If it doesn't come out then, you would probably need an impact driver. And that's basically a device that turns it as you hit it with a hammer. So it shocks it and turns it at the same time. What I did there was, another method is you could try to loosen it, then try tightening it, loosen it, tighten it, and then sometimes it'll break free. Next, take your BFH from your toolbox. This isn't the biggest FH I have, but give the rotor a good smack and take it off. Next, take a little brake clean and a wire brush and just go on the hub here and get rid of as much surface rust that you can. Another thing you could do is just take a little bit of grease. Now this could be anti-seize or any type of grease you have laying around, just coat the outside. And this is just so next time you replace the rotor, you don't have to smash it with your BFH. Now take your new rotor, install it, and line it up so that your set screw is in the right spot. Now some people may have heard to clean the surface of your rotors. This has a Z coat, which it's a coating for preventing rust while it sits on the shelf. And it also stays on anything that's not in contact with the brake pad. If you are replacing with a rotor, it doesn't have this coating and it has like an oil-based coating, you're gonna wanna take some brake clean and a rag and go over the surface on both sides where it makes contact with the brake pad. Next, we're gonna torque the set screw to 35 Newton meters. Next, we're going to clean up the caliper hold down bracket. So let's start by removing the pads. So these are a lot better than the driver side was. So these probably have between 3-4 millimeters left compared to a new pad. You can see the difference. Best thing to do, put the bracket in front of you and remove the clips, and just put the clips in the same orientation that you're taking them off. So when you have the new ones going on, you know exactly which way they came off. Just makes it easier. Take a little bit of brake clean and just spray that area. Go under it with a wire brush and you get all the loose stuff. Really want to keep this wet with brake clean, just because any type of brake dust that you're, you know, scraping up will go in the air and you're breathing it in. You can wear a mask too, maybe some eye protection. Now with a flathead screwdriver, just going to go in and clean up any type of harder brake pad material that's caked on. All right, repeat the same on the other side. This car has 120,000 miles. I think these pads were done once before, but you know, all things considered, it's not a lot of brake pad material on here. These look pretty good. All right, so let's take our new hardware. And like I said, this came off like this, so same orientation. Just watch out for these little tabs down here. These have to be on the inside. We're going to take the slide pins out. There's a rubber boot. So basically, you could gently pull it. Most of the time, they're going to separate like that on their own. If you're having a hard time, just take a flathead screwdriver or a pick and just carefully go around the edge. And as you're pulling, it'll separate. But just be careful not to rip the boot. So now that these are out, almost you could twist it as well, that'll help. Something to look out for is just any type of pitting or any type of debris that's on these. If there is, just use a wire wheel or a wire brush and just get it off. I mean, as you can see, these look pristine. So no need, I'm just gonna take some grease. And put a layer on there. I think I need a new set of gloves. All right. Let's put it back in for now. Same thing on the other side. Next, just take that boot and those will pop back on just like that. You can see they move nice and freely. Perfect. Take some of the Plasti lube or silicone grease and just lube the back of the pad. You can be liberal with this. This is controversial. Some people prefer to use some lube. Some people say you don't need it. I personally prefer it. Helps the vibration. And what you want to do is just a nice thin coat on the back and the ears. Basically any contact points between, you know, the caliper bracket. What you want to be cautious of is just make sure you don't get any grease on the pad surface, obviously. This is a friction surface. If you're putting grease on it, it kind of defeats the purpose. All right, now that the caliper bracket is all cleaned up, let's go ahead and put that back on. Two 15 millimeter bolts. Now we're going to snug these up. And once they're snug, we're going to tighten them and torque them down to 110 newton meters. Next, install the pads. Best to twist them in. You'll see I'm kind of going in on an angle and they'll pop right in. I don't want to touch that, so let me just get some screwdriver and you can just seat it into place. Perfect. Now the inboard pad, same thing, twist it in. Sometimes if it seats like, you know, one side before the other, try to straighten it out as you're applying pressure like that. So I'm pushing out on the top and pushing in on the bottom, and you'll see it just straighten right out. And then you can just push it into place. Perfect. Next, we're going to retract the caliper piston. So take an old pad and put it on the piston itself, and you can use some channel locks and just squeeze it back into play. And what this does is allow for the new pad to be installed, because obviously over time, as your pad thins out and it wears down, the piston compensates and it stays out. So when you go to hit the brake, obviously there's no gap there and you have instant performance. Now that the piston is retracted, flip the caliper over. Install it onto the carrier. And we're gonna put these bolts in, we're gonna thread them into place. Just a side note, always pay attention to the orientation of this hose. A lot of times when you take the caliper off and you put it on the side, sometimes this will get twisted up and you don't want this tangled, you want a nice free flowing hose like this. This is the proper orientation, so go ahead and thread these in. Once these are tight, again, go ahead and tighten these to 35 newton meters.
Again.
Best to use a 3-inch extension on this, just because of the location of the bolt. Next, put your wheel on. All right, guys, now that the wheel's on, you're almost complete with the job. Now you'd wanna go back in the car, turn the key back on, key position 2, get your scanner up and running, and take it out of service mode. Depending on the scanner, it may go through a calibration process. That's what our Altel scanner did in this case. So once you're done going through the calibration process, the last thing you wanna do is make sure you pump the pedal 3 times. That's gonna move the piston calipers out to meet the surface of the pad. This way there's no gap. And you're all set. If you like this video, don't forget to hit that like button. Also, make sure you subscribe. Thanks for watching.